talking today with Ihor Holubizky, who's the senior curator at McMaster Museum of Art. And we're getting a sense for what the world is of the curator, the decisions that the curator makes, the kind of concerns that the curator has. So give us, and here we are in an exhibition at the university, to give a first-hand sense for the decisions that Ihor faces, the kind of concerns he has, theoretical and practical. So it's your floor. You can just walk and talk, and he's going to cut, and just no issues.
All right. I'm sorry about this.
No.
I really apologize for everything I've ever done. When the challenge in this project, and I think this is a good one to talk about curatorial work, is that there is a topic that is very well written about in art history. Art history is, to me, is a methodology. The art historian has the advantage of not needing to be responsible for the thing itself. So they have free rein. Use any image, anything, to support their argument. The curatorial method is, in this case, there's two curatorial methods. One is to assemble these objects in order to, let's say, demonstrate or illustrate what the art historian does on a page. So these are objects in space. The curator of a collection, in this case, decided to work specifically from the holdings, is constrained by what you have available.
In the university collection.
In the university collection. Luckily, this collection is quite rich in the subject. But to leave it at that, at the subject alone, it's like, I know what chicken tastes like. But where does the chicken sit in the barnyard, so to speak? I don't know where I came up with that one, but let's say chickens. Everyone likes chicken. So as I was given the assignment, or the assignment came to me about expressionism, I thought, well, we can do it by the book. We have the work here. We can essentially put the book on the wall. But to reimagine it is to ask a question. And so that's where I began. So that's, I would call it the curatorial methodology, then becoming the exhibition methodology. The exhibition methodology is the objects in space and their, let's say, their relationships to each other, which may be obvious or not. I don't try to make it easy.
And are you trying to have an impact, an effect on the viewer? Like, how do you see this relationship to the person moving through the space, or is it your relationship to the work?
At first it has to be mine, but I'm thinking about the viewer. And in the end, it's an easy thing to say, but I would say raise consciousness. You can't raise consciousness, you can do two things. One is enchant the eye, which is relatively easy, you know. I like this, I like this color, I like this scene, it pleases a certain...
traditional notion of aesthetics related to beauty.
This is not about aesthetics.
But you have a different thing going on here.
So, at the heart, I had to ask myself what the question was, not that expressionism wasn't necessarily just a type and style, but it was an attitude towards life. And where does that begin? So in reimagining it, I rolled back. But to put it on the wall, in this case, not in the processional way, not in the chronological way, I then took my curatorial thesis and took it apart into areas, let's say, rooms that have posed questions or propositions rather than themes.
So each room was a kind of challenge to the guests.
Yes, and as it would have vista, there's a vista here. One is always moving around in space, the relationship of yourself to the object. So this particular room, to me, became the heart of the curatorial proposition, which is the Jobian question. And the Jobian question is from the Christian Hebrew scriptures. Job, righteous, wealthy man, all of a sudden, a series of disasters, everything is taken away from him. So his journey is, his question is, I'm a righteous person, why am I suffering? And it's his relationship to God. Luckily, because you have to have a bit of luck, we have over here William Blake, 1823, illustration from the book of Job. So my next question to jump from that is, what is that Jobian question in the modern age? And what I came to, perhaps not wholly unique, but I think in this context, is why do the innocent suffer? And that is, to me, is the story of the modern age, and why one uses this idea of expressionism, or even if one isn't, an artist isn't going to call themselves an expressionist, why do the innocent suffer? So in...
when we take a look at, you have a wall here with 12 images.
Yeah.
And a person passed through the wall, and it's quite homogeneous, and it's framed by the same artist, all of it?
Yeah. Yep. This is Pechstein. So this is after World War I. It was a pretty miserable war. It was the war to end all wars, little did they know. And what does he choose to do? Well, it's the Lord's Prayer. Each sheet of this folio is a line from the Lord's Prayer. So it has the theological, religious, mythic qualities in the images, this kind of rough woodcut immediacy, but it's also in the real time. It's in the time of 1921. It's not a biblical looking image. He is speaking to people today.
So you're fulfilling the Blake promise by taking the same issue of suffering in a modern context.
Yeah. So that's an interesting trajectory. And at the end of it, I decided to wind it further back, which is a 16th century German lamentation, which is Christ coming from the cross, the suffering, the grieving. So here is the grieving over, sacrifice, and then God as, you know, is it a loving God or a punishing God? So these are this complex question, our relationship to the maker.
Now you made a big jump.
Yeah, I know.
Because we've got the ancient, so to speak,
yeah.
We've got Blake, and then we've got the 1920s, and then you talk about vista. So suddenly the person takes a look at the fire extinguishers and the wall here. How do you logically, or how do you, in a curatorial work that transition?
Well, it's not logical. You know, I would say that this is the exhibition methodology has some intuitiveness. That is, what at the end of a wall, as you walk into the space, what draws you down there, what passes through? Why I chose the Joseph Beuys is that Beuys himself sees himself as a teacher, in which he is interested in society, this idea of free education, the Green Party before it was just eco, and natural history. So in this work, he has posed himself in front of a mastodon. And as I did research, uncovered that it was the Peel mastodon, the very first one that was excavated in the Americas, that finally found its way to Germany. I don't know how, apparently it got lost, I don't know. You know, it has to get on a ship. These things are big. Do you have anything to declare? Yeah, some bones. How does a mastodon go missing? But here he is, and he's connecting, and it's direct address in the way that he is standing, looking ahead. There is the past behind him, the man, natural history, and the fire extinguisher, which is kind of a metaphor. It's like, what is it? Is to put out the fire, and what is the fire? Well, we're starting to read a lot, right? So he leaves, doesn't give you a picture to digest, but questions that you can ask for yourself. And then to add, let's say, more trouble to it, because I think the troublesome things offer a way of thinking. And I like to think of it as a way of thinking and knowing the world.
And you have a contrast.
There is a Lehmbruck sculpture here, which seems out of place. Why is that here? Well, there is an image of the modern man, but it's also Boyce who speaks of Lehmbruck 2 weeks before Boyce dies. And he's not expecting to die, of course. No one expects to die.
We have a narrative link here, in a sense.
Well, he speaks of Lehmbruck as his teacher, not literally, but what he learned about space and the figure. So there is between this work, which is 1914, this is the 70-year gap in which my creative act and thinking about the world bridges 70 years very quickly. So we have, yes, there are hard cuts here. 16th century, early 19th century, early 20th century, late 20th century, and we swing back.
And you have a nice visual flow here.
Oh, yeah.
From the posture of the figure to the figure in the painting.
Yeah, of course. I mean, one also has to think about how your eye will move from something and make relationships.
So it's not just an intellectual narrative in a sense, there's the visual continuity.
Yeah.
Because this whole wall naturally flows. As a visual experience for even the, should we say, non-expert visitor to the gallery. It doesn't necessarily know the background to it, but yeah, they can see the movement and flow.
Well, I hope so. I mean, it's tough and it's not as easy as it. If it was a wall of dogs, we would walk in and say, ah, this is about dogs. Not quite as easy as that, but there is enough, I hope, that people will, through curiosity, and I'm a great believer that curiosity leads to self-learning, self-guided self-learning.
So here you have the near figure of a black man.
Yes.
And then you continue with the theme, but it's partially closed to a kind of a drape or a kind of curtain.
It's a tarpaulin. It's a used tarpaulin, and there's this cut figure. So we can see, let's say, the body in stress, as one may say, the body of you know, Christ being taken down from the cross. There's another little subtext here, which is the artist Betty Goodwin found inspiration in the work of Joseph Boyce.
So there's a continuity across Joseph Boyce, number one,
yeah,
and there's an intellectual continuity having to do with some of the baseline themes that motivated your room, and you carry the dissection of personhood or man here, continuing on to the lamentation.
Do you think it's man? Could be.
Whatever. Speaking in
there, you go.
Personhood.
Personhood.
We're being gender neutral.
And to position this, which I don't think anyone has ever done, but, you know, why not? It's a temporary engagement. I'm not writing history here. It's the Barlack porcelain sculpture of a Russian beggar woman. And it's Barlack's journey to Russia in 1907 that transformed him. That he saw in the misery of serfdom, and it was still serfdom, still Tsarist Russia, he saw human dignity, a way of living. So that figure, which is not necessarily pretty, it's an honest observation. So it's external observation where we could say that what Betty Goodwin is doing, it's internal. This room alone could be the exhibition, but that's not enough. So as you exit, you can enter into it. As you exit out, this is the spatial, it opens up. So the next room is, I call Triumph of Misery, which is, you know, one says that's
just a happy room.
You might think that's a contradiction, right? How can there be a triumph? Is it triumph over misery, or is the triumph through misery? But it's a no misery. So likewise, not chronological, but sits the responses of those German artists after World War I. And then 70 years later, across a wall, Canadian and European artists looking at, let's call it, the human condition. You know, where am I in the world? What is my relationship to society? And perhaps to a sense of being. You know, there's a lot of cruelty in the world. It continues. We're not going to solve it, but artists address it. So this is a kind of direct address in different ways.
And the goal is to, in a sense, have a,
experiential relationship with, moving through different renderings, different treatments by different people? And how did you make the choices on these walls?
Well, that was dictated by scale too. So the biggest paintings had to be in the biggest room.
Even for a curator, you can start intellectually, but they're practical issues that
absolutely
have to face.
Yeah. I mean, the painting in front of me is the largest work. If I put it on a wall over there, it would be like a black hole and would suck everything in. So you, as you walk in, it's to your, you see it to the side, but as you turn around and you look here, it's out of view. But there are these, you know, we have peripheral vision, we absorb these things. So as one circulates, things come in and out of view, and I hope that they relate.
So there's a design aspect embedded in the decisions you make regarding the space, not just the ideas you're addressing.
It's like living in the world. We walk through the world. The world isn't a book. A book is a book. One page, etc., right? And it's an organizing principle. In the world where, you know, the world is messy, it's full of sound, it's full of experiences, this happens, you know, you're driving along trying to find some place, you get lost and you try to find landmarks, you spot something in order for you to get back on track. So the exhibition to me is a version of being in the world, because this is what artists are, they live in the world, hence the title, Living, Building, Thinking. After that, it could be drinking, you know, it's living, building, drinking.
That's to recover from all,
all the thinking, yeah. And that's it's a very positive thing. Artists think, they engage, they activate.
So what is your relationship, how do you see your relationship, therefore, with the artist? Because you're not dealing with an individual artist, you're talking with artists collectively and the artist intentions, the artist themes. You're coming in there building different kinds of bridges.
Yeah.
And creating experiences based on juxtapositions and correlations.
Yeah. In some instances, I contacted the artists, the living artists, to tell them that I was doing this. I wanted to seek their permission to ensure that I was not misrepresenting them. Mm-hmm. I had email correspondence with Joyce Cairns, a Scottish artist, senior Scottish artist, also with I think it was, yeah, with Ken Curry.
So you
also,
a
Scottish.
Then, in your relationship,
well, yeah, because
in
that,
well.
Yes, because
not
they
to
make things.
Not to misrepresent.
I could just because I say it doesn't make it right. So I, you know, part of that is my own responsibility, ethical, intellectual responsibility.
And do you feel that there's an issue of talking about juxtapositions? I mean, put your painting next to another one. Is that a level of the conversation, or is that your own private matter?
That you can't open that. You can't ask an artist how well. I mean, one is aware of it if they say, but artists cannot place themselves in history. No artist is going to say, you know, you may want attention, but you can't say, this is going to be my position in history or art history.
So the curatorial vision,
yeah,
at a certain level, is above and below. You're below,
yes,
in the sense of the lived world, and above in the sense that you're making decisions about the juxtapositions and given the design space issues that you face in order to maximize the learned experience of the gallery museum visitor.
Yeah. Well, there's a hard decision. There are potentially 400 works that could have been in this exhibition. I've got room for 100. And in fact, at the last, and now, you know, you work through a kind of modeling that's kind of, it's like a self-modeling, but it's not a design exercise, but it is actually to visualize for yourself and think through it. At the very last moment, in the other room, there were two works at the end before the boys, Leonard Baskin, Angel of Death, and then Marcus Lupertz. And I thought, wow, these are great, wonderful works. I walked in and said, they're crowding the boys. If there was 3 more meters, I would have had them in. I said, no, let's take them out. And I felt that it didn't fall apart.
So it's the work in the space, both intellectually and the actual space of the gallery.
Well, I experience it first, right?
Yeah.
So if I do it, I feel confident enough that I can, that the visitor, and the visitor will have a myriad of responses. You cannot control how, I mean, an artist will tell you, I make something, I have intent, this is my message, I can't control what that is in the world. Tony Sherman, I'm sure, spoke of that.
Yeah. So two final questions. What's the most gratifying thing for you in the act of doing, curating a show? What is the most gratifying for you?
When it works.
And it works means?
When I become the viewer and I can look, in a sense, look objectively on my own work without seeing it as my work. It then goes back into the world. Mm-hmm. So like I know I spent 3 years working through all of this. This is the second version of it. I walk in, I'm going, oh, I'm looking at artists' thoughts and their visual languages.
And feeling it.
Yeah. And I'm not, it's not what I did.
Yeah.
You know?
So it's a 3-year project as a whole.
Yeah.
In the two iterations of it.
Yeah. And there will be a third one. And it will be different again.
In the sense of reconfiguring the paintings?
Yeah. Well, this
bringing
is,
in other ones under the
yes.
same theme.
Yeah. Yeah. The same publication, but looking at the space, you know, there's certain things, physical things. I mean, this impossible to ship. This weighs a ton. And I know we've taken it put it on and off the wall like 4 times. And, you know, when you're standing at the back of a painting, you learn a lot.
You but know. The reality of it.
Well, no, but it's also in the making of it. There's a physicalness to it. There's a thing to this. You get, you know.
So you're not just pointing, I want it here, want it there. You're actively involved in placement as well. So there's the physical experience of curating. There's a kind of Olympic event aspect to it.
When I told a young curator many years ago who said, come on down, we're installing a show. I said, I'm working here. I said, yes, but that's the work too, is to be in the space and to have contact. There is really no substitution. There's no, this thing about oil paint, by the way, never dries. It's like, it could, 500 years, it's you walk into a vault and I can smell it. And it's just like, wow. You know, it's, bronze doesn't smell as much, but there's a touch to something. It's a very palpable thing. And you go, you know, I used to describe art as the thing that artists do by taking perfectly good materials and making them useless, right, you know? You have a piece of wood and you carve it. Well, that piece
kill
of wood's
wood.
Not, you kill the wood, you know, it's like the wood, you can't do anything else with that wood. But in it, you know, there's some kind of a miracle that's guided. I wouldn't know how to do this. When you walk up to something and you look at like just the handling, like on the edge of this painting, it's red. That's the ground. You think, well, why does he paint red? I said, because the paint on top, which doesn't show the red, gives it a richness and depth, right? So there is in this.
So you learn a bit of the artist's secrets. Now,
yeah.
In closing, what is your advice to the young would-be curator? How would you say, because one of the points you're making is be actively involved, get your hands dirty, so to speak, not just visualizing the space at a distance, but understanding how the viewer will feel it and actually physically becoming involved with the process. So it's a very, very intimate treatment of the curator. We began with the discussion of the intellectual view of the curator, the abstract choices that you face in choosing the artworks, but then when you actually deal with their juxtaposition, we began to talk about the space, it can only handle this, and if it's there, it'll have a bad impact. Yeah. And then you're actually talking about the physicality of it.
Yes.
So the curator is really a multidimensional person, both intellectual and physically engaged.
Yeah. And the one piece of advice, a little bit, is don't become enamored of your own ideas.
In the sense that?
Live in the world.
And the world, in part, involves the viewpoint of the visitor.
Yes.
And the viewpoint of the world from which the images come.
Yeah. At home, I can do anything I want.
In the gallery, you're more responsible?
Yeah, you have a responsibility. I believe in that responsibility. And it will not change the world, but one hopes, as I said at the outset, raise consciousness. That's pretty good.
And finally, how do you see yourself in relationship to institutions? Because we spoke about your relationship with the viewer and your responsibility to the artist, raising the viewer's consciousness, but you're also, as a senior curator, embedded in an institution with varying constraints and varying opportunities. What have you learned from that? It can be pretty scary and open the door for another conversation.
Well, it's if you want to know the beast, being in the belly of the beast is a good way of knowing it. It's easy to criticize, you know, it's easy to kind of talk about the beast from the outside. When you're in it, you start to understand those dynamics, and they're not necessarily all constraining, but they are practical. And you know, there's a real and practical thing. It is for an artist. I've asked an artist, why did you make something that size? I said, well, that's the biggest thing I could get out of the door. So, you know.
So the lesson is, use your mind, be aware of other people, face the realities of institutions, but get your hands dirty in the sense of being involved, and learn the lessons from that process.
And change your socks regularly.
Thank you very much, Ihor. That's the advice. Always good.
No, actually, the line was, we were doing this thing about...
The line again.
No, this was it.
What you didn't talk about that you should talk about is when you create an exhibition, you question your own premise within the exhibition.
Yes.
And that's a really important feature that you, I think, have mentored many other curators who are all over the country and all over the world. This is a very contemporary idea that you have, in my mind, initiated and propagated with the people that you've influenced. And the importance of that is that the exhibition isn't your narrative.
No.
Right?
No.
You open the door with your narrative, but you also add things in there that question its own validity. Mm-hmm. Is my idea right?
Yes.
When you have to be open to the criticism or open to the risk, you're taking a risk.
It's a huge risk.
You take a risk.
Well,
artists
take a risk, there's no safe way around that one.
And the other really important point is that a curator can destroy the work, the validity of the work itself.
In what
badly
sense?
Installed badly exhibition.
Well, it's also, you know, it's not my line, it's Brian Robertson, is that it is easy to betray the values entrusted to you. So if you think about that, it's not what I like or dislike, but you are aware of the values that, yes, they are entrusted to you. As an institutional curator, I'm responsible for the entire collection, which spans 500 years of Western art and includes antiquities 2,000 years. I'm responsible. I'm entrusted with those objects, those tokens of culture. But yes, also the values.
So Stacey's essentially saying that there's a moral dimension to what he does.
Moral dimension.
It's not just intellectual. It's a moral responsibility to the artists, that they're realizing they're taking a risk, not misrepresenting.
And the juxtaposition of these works, as he talks about, is intuitive, and he, you know, 40 years of doing this, I get a feeling for it. And many curators who are been doing this for a long time, they work from their gut, they put it together. But the relationship between the works themselves can either help a viewer understand the work or can really distance you from the work itself. And very often you're going to institutions where you can't even look at the work because it's so badly installed that doesn't resonate at all.
So how important for you as an artist is your relationship with the curator in an installation situation?
It's symbiotic.
It's crucial. It's
symbiotic. One needs the other. Right?
Because the artist
has their own vision and they see it from their own perspective, and they're not necessarily thinking about how the general public's going to understand that, or the context of the space, or the history of where they are. They're thinking about what they know. And a curator brings a whole other reinterpretation, another layer, if you like, of appealing off the author, another insight, another lens to look at that work.
And the artist has to be receptive. Everybody's adjusting to everybody.
The artist doesn't have to be receptive. You get lots of artists who throw fits. I can't stand the way this is done. You've done horrible things to my work. You hear it all the time. It's something that
he's on the edge.
It can be true that you work with the best intentions that you've misunderstood what I'm doing. Go, really? Okay. So hang on. This is not a confrontation. Now it's like you've got to step back and say, all right. It's the error of your ways, in a sense.
So there's a process to hanging an exhibition or setting up an exhibition where in working with the artist registers a complaint that is reasonable. You're prepared to make the adjustment?
Yes.
Well, when I first met Ihor at Harborfront, I had some challenges that he had to deal with, right? The water piece.
Well, that's the second time. That was a really good challenge.
His histories go back a long way.
Yeah. It's 35 years, yeah.
And the challenge has to do with?
I was putting a rather kinetic and ephemeral work into a public space that required technology and support from a facility that wasn't really equipped to do that. And I was breaking a lot of rules.
Yeah.
In a sense that?
Well, in this case, it was a very large water.
Well, this is the water, this is the piece that throws the water.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
So you're breaking a rule for the fire department, for flooding.
All kinds of liability.
Safety, liabilities.
Yeah. Yeah.
And things I never considered.
Yeah. Well, it's in your studio, you're throwing water, you don't care.
Well, and I'd shown it in other places, but...
You didn't actually tell me at the time that that had flooded the previous...
I did keep that quiet.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, so there you go.
The admissions come out in a little.
It's like halfway through the flight, the pilot says, by the way, this is the first time I've flown a plane, right? Okay.
That's when I crashed. Yeah.
So I said, okay, but did you throw the water in the end?
Well, in the end, of course, I threw the water, and Ihor supported that. And he supported it. I used this glass structure, which was outside, tempered glass, that carried the water back. And this was a whole thing about transformation. And they had not done anything quite like this in the outside area of Harbourfront. Mm. There were some kinetic things that moved in the wind or moved around, but nothing that was really powered and had such a directed force. And what happened is the elements of the environment had an impact on the work. I mean, sometimes
as an example, people get wet.
Okay. So suddenly it's shooting water, and you happen to be walking by, and the wind blows and it shoots water on you.
Everybody has umbrellas and raincoats if they want to come to the show.
And then the other problem, which I had never anticipated, and it was the day of the opening, and I came down to see the work, and I was very proud. And there were hundreds, if not thousands, of people there. And it was a hot, sunny day.
Harbourfront being on the edge of Lake Ontario, lots
and
of guests.
And this glass trough, which was, I think, about 20 meters long, maybe 15 meters long. 15 meters long. This glass trough was filled with children. They climbed in.
His legal liabilities were pushed in the air.
Yeah. I was so terrified by what I saw, I turned around and I left. Because I had never anticipated kids would sit in this glass, which was, I didn't know.
You glued it. Well. You didn't know if the glue would hold.
Would it hold?
So the lesson in this phase of the conversation is a 35-year friendship requires adjustment all around between the artist and the curator, who in the moment are able to make a compromise.
Well, compromise and learning together. I think that's the fundamentals. That when I say symbiotic, it's not just about figuring out where a relationship between a work goes on a wall, but as Ihor talks about in terms of his communication with the artist, it's an intellectual, emotional, shared space.
So it's not just the work.
It's not just
the interaction with the artist who is a living and available in that situation to negotiate not just the meaning of the space, but the practical realities of the space.
And I would argue, I'm not sure everyone would agree, but I would argue that curators very often influence artists by the dialogue that they have. In the sense that the artists think differently about their work or think differently about the approach to their work.
Planning ahead.
See it in a different context than they would have, and they start to move in a different direction.
And is that a different conversation with the curator than the person who's reviewing it for a journal or a newspaper? Because that person's still more detached and more judgmental. The curator
I don't see a relationship between a reviewer and a curator at all. I don't see that.
So the relationship between the artist and the reviewer is much more distant and final, so to speak, because they're passing judgment. Yeah. With the curator, it's a more practical installation situation.
So the curator passes judgment. That is true. The curator does pass judgment in their selection of work. Okay, or decides what
this, not that.
But I think that relationship is about has a shared cause, right? The curator has a shared cause. They're bringing together works to create a vision. The artist brings together their own work within a vision. A reviewer is something a completely different.
A judge.
A judge, and the public is a judge, and I think I don't see the same level of intellectual, emotional engagement.
Well, I come to the same conclusion that there's a strong moral aspect to the curator's world, beginning with the intellectual aspect of representing the work in its meaning, and then a different moral relationship, a meaningful relationship with the artist, representing the artist, engaging the artist able to be responsive, so everybody's growing as a process, and hence the notion of education. The title of the exhibition is?
Living, Building, Thinking.
There you go. Thank you very much.